Hey, good morning, First Christian Church. It is good to see you. Yes. It's a time for us to come as a family. It's a time for us to worship and to celebrate and to glorify God. And it's beautiful, beautiful to see all the people here today. It was funny because I was sitting up here with Monty, and all of a sudden a song hit my head, and I started singing His Love Endures Forever. You guys know that song? We're not going to sing it right now. But I started singing it, and Monty started singing it, and I'm like, I got to read that part in Psalm. So I turned to Psalm chapter 106, and this is what we're supposed to be doing this morning as well. It says this in verse 1, "Praise the Lord, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever." That's what we're supposed to be celebrating as a family here. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be singing praise to Him, glorifying Him, because His love endures forever. It's a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful thing to see. All right, so I only have one announcement that we're going to have this morning. Tonight at 6 o'clock, meeting right in here, we're going to have a prayer meeting. And we're probably going to be doing this quite regularly on Sunday nights. Sometimes we'll have a Bible study over in the other room. Sometimes we're going to have prayer in here. And I want you to challenge yourself to be here for this prayer. Because we're going to talk about prayer. We're going to see what it's like. And then we're going to be praying as a congregation for this church, for you, for our community, for our country. Because, man, don't we need prayer? We do. We do. We need prayer. So meet us tonight at 6 o'clock right here and let us pray for our country. Why don't you go ahead and stand as we have our opening prayer, and we'll be going into our first song. Heavenly Father, we glorify Your name. We honor You. We bless Your name on high. And Father, we just want to make sure that when we come together on Sunday mornings, it's not about us. It's all about You. It is about singing praise to You. It's about praying to You. It's about glorifying who You are. It's about singing about Your love, which is forever. Your love endures forever. And Father, it's a beautiful, beautiful thing when we rely on that, when we seek on that, when we come after You with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, Father, we see Your blessings that come upon us. But as we are in here this morning, as we have come together to glorify You, we're getting rid of all the things that are happening in this world. We're not thinking about Father's Day. We're not thinking about, just all the things that we have planned for this afternoon. We're not thinking about what happened this past week at work. We're not thinking about any of those things. This morning, we are coming here this morning to glorify and praise our Heavenly Father, who is the best dad in the entire world. Father, we just want to praise Your name. We just want to thank You so much for all that You do. And You do so much for us. You have taken care of us so many times. And especially since You sent Your Son, Jesus Christ, who came and died on the cross for us. And with that death on the cross, there is victory in Jesus. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Go ahead and stand. Stand.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about His healing of his cleansing power, revealing how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there a song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Would you please have a seat? When it comes to our time of communion, we have our cup, we have our wafer, we have it there as a reminder. It's a reminder of God's love for us. It's a reminder of Jesus' love for us and the willingness and the sacrifice that he was going to go through for our forgiveness of our sins. So when we take this, we remember what he has done for us. We take this to remember his body. We take this to remember his blood that was shed for us. And I'm going to read just one little passage. It's in 1 John chapter 3. Starting in just in verse 16, it says, "This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters." This is what we do. It's because of that love that he died on a cross for us. Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you so much. I thank you for just reminding us of what love is. And there are so many times where we get so sidetracked with this world that we lose sight of what the sacrifice was, and we lose sight of what forgiveness means, and we lose sight of what love really is all about. And so when we come to this time of communion, this is our time for us to remember. This is our time to reflect. This is our time to give praise to our brother Jesus for what he has done for us. Jesus, we recognize who you are. We recognize you as our Savior. We recognize you as the example of what it means to love. And Jesus, when we take this wafer and we drink this juice, we remember your body and your blood that was shed for us. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. After you've prayed and reflected, please go ahead and take your communion. Thank you.
Did you know that the word believe is used in the Bible 257 times? 257 times. As Christians, we believe in something that with our eyes that we can't see, or so we've been told. But we can see God. We can see God. I can see God this morning in all your faces. You can turn around and look at the person next to you, and you can see God in that face. You can see God in the acts that we do of loving kindness to each other and to people that we don't even know. We believe. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should be saved, would be saved. We believe.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, only one foundation. We believe. We believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only
believe in God the Father.
in Jesus Christ is the true basis for our faith, the gift that he gave us on the cross. Hebrews 10:22 says, "Let us draw near with a true heart and in full assurance of faith." Jesus, please draw me nearer to your precious bleeding side, Lord, and we will pray that we never forget the gift that you gave us with your suffering and agony on the cross.
I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious pleading side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious leading side.
Amen.
I hope you have a wonderful day.
When I was at Navistar, a lot of those people came from BMW, and they all knew him, and they would all tell me how hard he
grew up and still growing up to this day, every time we talk to each other before we get off the phone, we say we love you. And I know he means it, and I mean it just as well. And we still give each other hugs and handshakes, and, you know, we just have a good time. And I love him.
I love my dad because he just likes to go hunt with me and does everything for me. And he's such a kind man that I wish that every father would be like that.
I love my dad because he provides for us. He's always been there for me, and he's just the greatest dad in the world.
What's your most special memory?
His boldness.
His boldness.
Yeah. Strong will.
What's your favorite memory?
Waiting on Dad to come home when I was little, and I'd stay in the living room until like 6 in the morning.
I would Disney. That's fine. If I could give him anything, it'd be his signed Alabama football by Paul Bryant, his dad. So I can't do that. But if I could, that's what it would be.
If I could give him
kiss. No way. I can't have a kiss. Yo yo.
Da da da. Da da da. Da da da. Da.
Parker, what do you like to do with your daddy?
Play.
You do?
Yeah.
What's your favorite thing that Daddy drives?
Tractor.
Who do you want to grow up big and strong like?
A tractor.
A tractor. What about your daddy?
Yes.
Okay. What are you going to tell him? Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, Granddaddy in heaven.
Happy Father's Day, Granddaddy in heaven.
My favorite memory of him is me and Sarah Kay
Day.
Happy Father's Day.
He's happy when we're happy.
We would do anything in the world to make him happy.
Yes.
To keep him happy.
We love him a lot.
We really do.
He's amazing.
He is amazing. What is the best memory that you have of him growing up?
Quarantine prom.
What's the best thing about your day?
He's fun. He cares about us.
Where would your daddy go if he could go anywhere?
To the Army.
To the Army?
Not to New York.
Obviously. Why wouldn't he go to
New York? I see his cat through the window.
Okay.
I see his cat through the window.
So he'd go to the Army.
Ireland or Germany.
There's a cat.
Well, who would he take with him?
Me.
Obviously the killer.
Me, he loves me the most.
If y'all could give him anything in the world, what would it be? There you go.
See, that's the right answer.
That's exactly what I mean.
That's exactly what he
means.
It's not really just things that make him happy. It's
right. It's other people's love.
Right.
And other people's, like, effort and appreciation and other things. So.
Okay. Your daddy's smart man, huh? Is he smart?
He's a soldier.
A soldier. Ooh. Are you going to be a soldier one day?
I'm going to grow up like daddy and be strong muscles.
That is awesome. What is something that y'all have done with your daddy that was so much fun?
Go to Six Flags and do nothing.
Go to Six Flags.
That was fun. What's your favorite, I guess, childhood memory?
I wish my dad a very happy Father's Day. He's the best dad that a filmmaker or creative could ever ask for, because always I'm asking him for weird things I need for a movie, or hey, can you help me do this? And he's always been very willing to either give me what I need or help me build something or just help me be resourceful. And you know, growing up, he was also very heavily involved with Scouts with me, which taught me to be prepared and helped me to learn a lot of life lessons that have really aided me today in both my career and my personal life. And he also was super supportive when I bought this house. It was a fixer-upper and needed a lot of work. And he always encouraged me to do all the work that I needed to do, but also teach me what I needed so that I could continue to fix this place up and continue doing it over the years. And I just want to thank you, Dad, for everything you've done and all your support. Love you.
Happy Father's Day, Daddy. We love you and appreciate everything you do for us. I hope you have a wonderful day.
I was at Amstar. A lot of those people came from BMW. They all knew him. They were all telling me how hard he was. So.
Right. Well, there we go. Happy Father's Day, though, guys, huh? Happy Father's Day. Yeah, it's great. Oh, and I'm glad to see everybody here. I'm glad that we could just come together and worship, and we can do the social distancing like we are, right? So, yeah. This past week, Heather's been working a lot, and I know that, and the pool is her new baby. Because our kids are growing up, and she likes to take care of the pool. And so yesterday in the morning, we were out there looking at the pool, and it's cloudy. And that's one of the things that Heather can't stand about the pool, is that it gets cloudy. And I looked at her, and this is before we were going on our trip over to Starkville, and I said, "Man, did you notice how cloudy the pool is?" And she looked at me, and she goes, "Why do you hate me?" And I'm like, "I don't hate you, I love you." And she's like, "Now I have to go to get to the pool store and get the chemicals." And I'm like, "Good, go. And so she was gone for hours yesterday afternoon. hours. She went shopping with Cameron. They went out to Columbus to the pool store. I was moving some of the rocks, staging it around different places in the back, making a nice little path. Dustin has been working at our house and moving rocks and doing landscaping, and it's going to be amazing when it's done. And after about an hour and a half of moving the rocks around, I go, hey, there's no one here. Jordan's been at work since 11. He's going to work until 7. I'm going to get in the pool by myself. It was amazing. Floating in there, taking up the sun. This is perfect. And then my family came home, so then I got out. But it was fun. But it was fun. All right, I'm glad you guys are here. One of the things that we're going to be looking at today is in the book of Matthew. So turn the book to Matthew, looking at chapter 22. And of course, we're going to be doing the chapter, so I want you to be prepared for that. So Matthew chapter 22, starting in verse 1. Matthew 22, starting in verse 1. There's no sleeping in church, okay? Matthew 22, verse 1, starting in verse 1, it says this. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused. And you have to ask yourself, why would you refuse to go to a wedding banquet? Why would you refuse to go to a celebration like this where everybody is coming to glorify and the son's wedding and everybody is invited to go? Everybody was invited. And so he invited him and said, listen, it's ready. It's ready to go. All you have to do is show up. If you've been invited to the wedding and you go to the banquet, there's a feast already there for you. But what did the people do? They refused. And I know that's a lot of people in church too. I know that there's these invitations that keep going out and you keep are being asked over and over and over again to come to the feast, to come to the banquet, to do all those things, have that relationship with God, have those things that you know that you need, and people are still refusing to come forward. I'm not talking about at the end of the service. I'm not talking about the invitation time. I'm talking about in life. In life, people are still refusing to come down. Then he goes on and says this. Look at verse 4. Then he sent some more servants and said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My ox and my fattened calf have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. He's asking over and over and over again, come to the banquet, come to this thing, come to this festival, come to this that I have in store for you. But they keep saying, no, no, no. They keep refusing. They keep refusing. And he's just saying, I don't understand. Why don't you want to come? Then he goes on. Verse 5. But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. But what did the people do? They went off to their businesses. They went off to their fields. They went off to all those things. And here's the thing for us to remember. And here's the thing for us to think about as well. The invitation has been out for you to step up. The invitation has been out there for you to embrace this walk that we're supposed to have with Christ. And a lot of us are still refusing to do that. Why? Work, family. I had the opportunity to use a saying that I heard not too long ago from another minister. He got done preaching a sermon. And someone came up to him and says, I can't believe that you said this. He goes, what did I say? Well, you said that only those who believe in Jesus Christ can get to heaven. He goes, I didn't say that. He goes, you just did. You just said it in your sermon today. He's like, no, I didn't say that. Jesus did. And with us, there's a lot of times that we're going to see things in the scriptures. There's a lot of times that we're going to be reading things that we don't like, and we're just going to say, I'm too busy. I don't want to. Goes on. Listen to this. Then he said that the king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their cities. Then he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite the banquet, anyone you find. So the servants went out to the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. There's only so many times he's going to keep asking you over and over and over again to come to the banquet. He's finally just going to say, that's enough. We're going to invite others. There's a lot of times that we just invite those that we know. It's time for us to invite others. It's too many times we know the people at that work or at school or whatever. It's time for us to invite others. I did. I went up to, I told you about Skeeter, and asked him to come to church. Now I go someplace else. I'm like, all right, where else am I going to go? Who else am I going to invite? Went over to co-op, started talking to the people over there. You need to come to church. I even said to Katie, you know Tommy Redis? Yeah, that's my blah, blah, blah. Oh, great. You need to invite him to come to church. He goes, yes, sir, I will. And I said, and you need to invite yourself to come to church too. And she looked at me and she goes, yes, sir. Go outside your comfort zone. Go outside your circle. Invite people to come. Look around you. Look around you this morning. Look at all the people who are here. It's because of invitations. It's because of Facebook. It's because of people that we know. Invite them to come. Invite them to come to the banquet. Then he goes on. Then he said to the servants, but then when the king came to see the guests, he noticed a man there that was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked him, how did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend? The man was speechless. Verse 13, then the king told the attendants, tie him hand and foot, throw him outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen. We always think that we always have time. We always think that if we just keep going down the path, we always think that there's time for us to turn around and go to the banquet, but there's not. We have a limited amount of time for us to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We only have a limited amount of time to apply all the things that we are learning in this. We only have a limited amount of time before the banquet is actually starting. He looks at you and he says, why aren't you dressed? And we always have those excuses. We always have those sayings. We always say the things like, but I went to church. And I sang in the choir. And I preached your sermons. And how did you get in here? You're not dressed. Guys, I want to pour on you. I just want to ask you over and over and over again. You have to stretch yourself in your walk. You have to do as much as you possibly can to get into that banquet. You've got to make sure that you're living the life that you know that you're supposed to be living. You have got to be that example. You have to make sure that your walk is the walk and your talk is the talk. Because that banquet is going to be there and he's going to look at all of us and we're going to be surprised. We're going to be surprised at who actually gets in and those who don't. We're going to be surprised about it because we would think, but I went to church with them. And we did Bible studies together. That minister was fantastic. That blah, blah, blah. And we can just start listing all these things. And he's looking at us. He's going, listen. You don't have the right attire on. You don't have the right wedding clothes on. You cannot come in here. And he ties them up and gets rid of them. I don't want that to be you. I don't want that to be me. So it's about that spiritual depth that we all have to get to. It's that time that we spend in the scriptures. Are you reading? I read one of my favorite books in the Old Testament this week. It was Jeremiah. Jeremiah talks about the preachers, and he talks about prophets and priests, but I think of ministers and pastors. And he talks about how they're deceiving people and they're leading people astray. And I read that and I say, I keep looking at this saying, I pray that I'm not doing that. I pray that my sermons are real. I pray that my interactions with you are real. I pray that when I'm out in public and you see me, that I am who I am. Tuesday morning, was that when we got the phone call for the reporter? Tuesday. We'll say Tuesday. We just happened to be here to answer, all right? And so she said, well, actually, our pastor's here. Do you want to talk to him? And she was like, he was like, yeah. So I get on the phone. He's like, hey, I'd like to come interview you to find out what you're doing about the virus, when you're opening, when you're doing all those things. And he goes, can I be there at 11? I said, no, I got to go drop off my truck someplace. So I'm going to, can you make it noon? Yep, we'll do it. So noon, Samantha comes in my office and she goes, so is he coming today? I said, yeah, he's coming at noon. And she looked at me and she said, you're not wearing that shirt. No, she said, you're not wearing that shirt. No, would you like to change your shirt? It was a regular t-shirt that I normally would wear. And I looked at her and I go, good call, good call. So I went home and put on that other golf shirt that I bought myself when on vacation. And that is what I wore. And I had so many people comment, I can't believe you wore shorts. And? Huh? And they said, I can't believe you wore those shoes. What's wrong with my shoes? But I said, I had to be me. I had to be genuine. You have to be you, and you have to be genuine. And you have to be you in your Christian walk and be genuine about it. Don't put on a front. I wasn't going to dress up in a suit. Could you imagine seeing me on TV in a suit? No. That's not me! Right? Yeah, it would have been funny. But in this Christian walk, you have to be genuine in your walk, or you don't get in the banquet. I have friends who tell me all the time, people I didn't go to Bible college with, and I know the scriptures, but, right? I know the scriptures, but. We can't live that way. Let's go on. Verse 15, it says, then the Pharisees went out and laid plans to trap him in his words. They sent out their disciples to him with their Herodians. Teachers, they said, we know that you are a man of integrity and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You aren't swayed by others because you paid no attention to who they are. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay imperial tax to Caesar or not? Jesus, knowing that their evil intention, said, you hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used to pay the tax. They brought a denarius, and he asked them, whose image is there, and what inscription? Caesar's, they replied. And he said to them, so give back to Caesar what is Caesar, and to God what is God's. When they heard this, they were amazed, so they left him and went away. Pay your taxes. Give your portion to God. I was so excited this past week. I looked at our Renaissance account, and my tax return finally got here from January. Oh, I overpaid. And the government was so nice, they said, you can have it back. But I paid. And I give to church, too. Goes on. That same day, the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, came to him with a question. Teacher, they said, Moses told us that if a man dies without having children, his brother must marry the widow and raise up offspring for him. Now there were seven brothers among us. The first one married and died, and since they had no children, he left his wife for his brother. The same thing happened to the second and third brother, right on down to the seventh. Finally, the woman died, and now, with the resurrection, whose wife will she be of the seven, since all of them were married to her? Jesus replied, "You were in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God." That happens to us. That happens to us too often. We start to think a certain thing and we start to believe a certain thing because we don't know this. You don't know the scriptures. You're not reading. You're not praying. You're not seeking after. Sometimes we just follow our own guidelines and we can't. We've got to follow this. He said, "You're in error because you don't know the scriptures." If there's one thing that you've learned about me in the last 2 years that I've been here, you got to know the scriptures. If there's something that you've learned about me since I've been here in the last 2 years, you know that you do not show up at church on Sunday without having your Bible. You don't show up on Sunday night Bible study class without your Bible. It's either physical book on an iPhone or an Android, if you have one of those things, or a tablet, whatever the case may be, you don't come to church without it because I want you to know your scriptures. And you have to know your scriptures so that you don't fall prey to things that are not in there. You need to study the words of God. He said, "You're in error because you don't know the scriptures. You don't know them." That's not an excuse about not getting to the banquet. "God, I didn't know." "Did you have a Bible?" "Yeah, but." "You can't come in." "Yeah, but." "You can't come in. You didn't know the scriptures." "Oh, but no one taught them to me." You've got it. You should know it. All right. Going on to verse 30. "At that resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven. But about the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what God has said to you? I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living." When the crowds heard this, they were astonished at it. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees and the Pharisees, got together. One of them, an expert of the law, tested him with the question, "Teacher, what is the greatest commandment of the law?" And Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind." Can you say that? Can you? Can you honestly look at yourself? Can you honestly look at your relationship with God? Can you honestly look deep inside of you and say that you love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength? Can you honestly say that? It is the greatest commandment there is. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Make sure that everything that you do is for His glory. Everything that you say is for His glory. Everything, everywhere that you go, people will see it, that you love Him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That is the greatest commandment, and are you living that way? That people know you're different. Once or twice a month now on Thursdays, I go up to Tupelo and I meet with 5 or 6 other ministers. And we have breakfast at the Huddle House. And as we were there, the waitress came over and she was taking our order. And she looked at me and she said, "What would you like?" "I will take the ham and cheese omelet." And yes, I had the ham and cheese omelet. She goes, would you like toast or a biscuit? And I go, what kind of toast? And she goes, oh, don't you be difficult with me. And I went, I'll take the toast and I'll have a cup of coffee. And she was like, okay. And she went and she got it and she brought it back and my order was wrong and another person's order was wrong and another order was wrong. And so she went and she got them all fixed and she brought us back our meals that we finally ordered and we were eating. And she was like, I am so sorry about all this. And we're like, it's okay. It's okay. The guy in front of me was paying. And she asked him, she said to him, thank you guys for being so nice and so patient with us. And he said, it's not a problem. She goes, you guys must be a bunch of Christians. He goes, well, yeah, we're actually a bunch of ministers. And she, I knew it. You guys were the best. And we're like, oh, here's an extra couple bucks, you know? But if we had been rude, or if we had been mean, or if we had been gossiping, or if we had been doing all of other things that a lot of people do, she never would have known it. And she asked him, where do you preach at? Baldwin. Oh, cool. Where do you preach at? Amory. Oh, where do you preach at? West Point. That's a long drive for breakfast. And I go, it is. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. What else does it say? This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. There's a little twist in that, isn't there? First, you have to love yourself. Yeah, right? Yeah. You have to love yourself first. And how do you love yourself? You forgive yourself. You spiritually grow yourself. You mentally grow yourself. You love him first with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. He changes you. See, you can't learn how to love until you get his love in you first. You can't. All love comes from God. Not this earthly love, his love. Love your neighbor as yourself. Above the law and the prophets hang on these two commands. Got to ask you a question. Do you want to get into the banquet? Do you want to get in there and eat that fattened calf? Do you want to sit around the table? Do you want to enjoy the wedding? Do you want to be there when he comes and says to you, good and faithful servant, enter into joy today? You have to start with love. You have to have that in you first. And once that's in you, then you can give it to others. And love him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's going to take a change in you. It's going to take a change in all of us. So it starts with you. Our song of invitation that we have today is Softly and Tenderly. If you need prayer, I think the baptistry is out for right now, isn't it? So no baptism. We have a pool. So if you need to get baptized, not hang out and swim. But if you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and you want to get baptized into him, please come down as we sing our song Softly and Tenderly. If you need prayer, please come down as we sing Softly and Tenderly. Let us stand and let us worship him. Thank you so much, Father.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Beautiful, weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling.
It's a beautiful thing to see what happens when we, as your children, realize and learn the things that we're supposed to, and we just come after you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And we come after you regardless of what happens around the world, whatever the circumstances where we are in, if we just learn to love you with everything that we have inside of us and praise you for everything that is inside and everything that happens, it's amazing what happens when we go down that path. Father, I'm asking that you change our hearts. Help us to see what we need to do. Change our minds. Help us to see what we need to do. Change our spirits. Help us to see what we need to do. So that no matter where we go, no matter what we do, we are glorifying you. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross. Thank you for being that example of what we need to do and how we need to live. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice on the cross. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Solid blue.